So today's topic is the big theorem, Brouwer's invariance of domain. We have already seen last time a weaker version of this theorem, namely for n not equal to m, the Euclidean space Rn is not homeomorphic to Rm. This will be a consequence of the big theorem that what we are going to prove today. Namely, if x and y are two subsets of Rn, homeomorphic to each other, if one of them is open, then the other one is also open. Okay. So what you can do is think of the Rn and Rm, n less than m, then you put Rn as a coordinate subspace of Rm. Now you have two subsets. One is Rn cross 0, 0, 0 and another is Rm. Both of them are subsets of Rm. If they are homeomorphic, since the whole Rm is open, the Rn cross 0, 0, 0 should be also open. That is very easily seen that that is not the case. We can easily show that coordinate inclusions are not open sets. They are closed sets, but definitely not open sets. It's very easy to see. Therefore, Rn and Rm are not homeomorphic. So that will be an easy consequence of this big theorem. However, how we arrived at that? We arrived at by showing that Sn and Sm are not even homotopy equivalent to each other. This we would not have got from this theorem. Sn and Sm are not homeomorphic, we can prove from this theorem. But they are not even homotopy equivalent to each other, we would be able to prove. So that step, going through Brouwer's fixed point theorem and proving and going through Sperner lemma is not achieved by this big theorem. So you must know that is why that is justification for proving that one separately. Okay. So let us now prove the big theorem. Here again, the key lemma is a strengthening of our homotopy simple shell approximation, namely controlled homotopy. And that will give you a topological criterion for a point to be an interior point of a subset. I am talking about a subset of Rn. Take a subset of Rn. Whether some point is an interior point, it will give you a topological criterion for that one. Topological means it will be an invariant of the homeomorphism type of X. Whereas an interior point is a concept of an embedded object, X contained inside Rn. So what is its interior? Okay, if you take just a topological space, just like that, interior of X is the whole X, there is nothing else. But X as a subset of Rn has a different interior. However, this is independent of how X is contained inside Rn is the crux of this thing. So that is what we are going to achieve, which is actually much more stronger than invariance of domain itself. Invariance of domain, we will be catching it as a corollary, okay, as a consequence. So this is the general idea and the what is involved in the proof of this one. So let us now go step by step. As I have told you, the key lemma is whatever, say key step is lemma 6.6, which will lead to another theorem 6.8. I have stated separately because it seems to be much more stronger than, in some sense, not exactly, than Dvorak's invariance of domain itself. Okay, so this lemma is the following. Take a finite simple shear complex. Okay, let us say its dimension is less than some number m. Take a subset which is closed inside mod k. Given any function, any continuous map f from mod k to dm, dm is the unit disk in Rm, such that the subset A goes inside the boundary Sm minus 1. The lemma says that there exists a homotopy H from mod k cross I into dm of this function f, namely H of x 0 is fx for all x in mod k. This homotopy is relative to A, which means the point A is fixed throughout the homotopy, and the end result H of x1, that you can call it as G of x, this takes values inside Sm minus 1. In short, you can say that a function like this, when the dimension of k is smaller than m, such a function can be homotopically pushed into the boundary completely. That homotopy is achieving that. So that is the way to understand this one. Okay. The proof of this itself takes some time. All right. So that we will postpone it for next time. However, we shall assume this result and go ahead towards proving Brouwer's invariance of domain. So the first step is a ready-made homotopy theoretic corollary. Okay, now you take a subset, a closed subset of Sn. Okay, again, assume that this n is less than m. Then every map alpha from A to Sm minus 1, m minus 1 might have become equal to n, but it is n is still less than or equal to m minus 1. That you have to understand. Every map from A to Sm minus 1 can be extended to a map from Sn to Sm minus 1. If you replace this Sm minus 1 by a Euclidean space, this is nothing but, or DM or IM and so on, RN, DM, this is nothing but T's extension theorem, but with you know, RM or IN, etc. Instead of that, if you have a round sphere here, this is not a easy thing, but this comes immediately as a corollary to this theorem. So this is homotopy theory now, you see. This can be extended. Like we told you that the homotopy theory right in the beginning consists of these kind of things, extensions and liftings. So here is first time you are saying some such thing very clearly, that a map defined on a closed subset, any closed subset, can be extended to the whole space, provided the extending space Sn itself is of smaller dimension than the sphere. Okay, this without this condition, it is even false. Okay, in a way, this resembles T's extension theorem, and T's extension theorem will be used. How? you have a map from A into SM minus 1. You can include it in DM. Okay, if SM minus 1 is contained in DM. Once it is DM, this is just like, this is exactly T's extension theorem, that you can extend it to the whole of SN, because SN is normal, that's all. Okay, if you might have seen it only for real world functions, but then this can be, you can take this as various coordinate functions. First of all, DM can be replaced by I power M. Then there are M coordinate functions. Each of them you do, then you get a function and extension of this. That's all. So such that, so there is a map such that FA equal to alpha A means that this alpha can be extended, right? Now you take K to be boundary of delta N plus 1 as a simplicial complex, okay? Then mod K is precisely SN. It's homeomorphic to SN. Therefore, I can apply this lemma. Okay, I started the map here instead of F, I have alpha. Okay. All right. So, H be a homotopy given by the above lemma. See, alpha is given on A, but F is an extension, but it's taking values inside DM. So push it back to SM minus 1 by a homotopy. That homotopy is a relative homotopy, controlled homotopy. So it does not change the function on A, which is alpha. Therefore, the result H of X1 is equal to alpha X on A. Okay. So that is the proof of this. So we will use this one now, that any function from A to a sphere can be extended to the whole of SN, provided this N here is less than or equal to M minus 1. Okay. So the homotopy theoretic background is now complete. Now we have to do purely point set topology. Okay, so I recall a few things here just to make sure that you don't have any confusion. Okay, these are elementary things. Take any subset of a topological space. A point Z, point X inside Z, okay, is called a relative interior point of X if there exists an open subset U of Z such that X is in U is contained inside X. Of course, X must be a point of X if it is an interior point. Not only that, there must be a neighborhood. This neighborhood is not in X, it should be in Z. So that is the meaning of relative interior point of X. Okay, a point Z, X belongs to Z, is called relative boundary point of X if it is not a relative interior point of X, but not even relative point of the complement also. So such thing is called a boundary point, which is the same thing as saying every open set around X will intersect both X as well as its complement. Okay, so I'm just recalling what is the meaning of boundary and interior. To make it, the point relative interior emphasizes on that one. Okay, we are not looking at manifold theoretic boundary. For example, Dn, wherever it is, its boundary is Sn minus 1, right? If you include it as a subspace of Rn, then also it's true. But there is a different concept of boundary. So that is not the boundary that we are referring to here. This relative interior, relative boundary is purely embedded notion here. Okay. So now we come to relative boundary point of X as a property that every neighborhood intersects. That's what I told you. a subset of X, a subset X itself is open if all its relative interior points, okay, are all of its points are relative interior points. That's all. Yeah. The following theorem, which characterizes intrinsically the relative boundary points and hence the relative interior points, whether you give the characterization for interior points or boundary points, it will be the same. It will be read both ways, because it's characterization of a subset of a Euclidean space. Okay, that's what I'm telling you, is perhaps the strongest form of Brouwer's invariance of domain, because once we use this characterization to prove Brouwer's of domain, invariance of domain, obviously that will be stronger than this. Let us take the statement of this theorem. Take a compact subset of Rn. Okay, take a point in X. It will be a relative boundary point of X if and only if, for every t positive, there exists a r smaller than t, 0 less than r less than t, such that every continuous function on the complement of this open bar, x minus br of x to sn minus 1, has a continuous extension over the whole of x. This n minus 1 is the same thing as this, correspond to this n, n is the same here. So the statement is about compact subsets, but it can be easily extended to non-compact spaces also. So let us concentrate on compact set, concentrate on other parts of the theorem rather than why X should be compact and so on. That just helps. So here BR of X is the open ball of radius R around X. Okay, so there are if and only if parts, right? So I am going to prove the implication here. Take U equal to BR of X intersection X. This is just a short notation every time instead of writing this one. For some arbitrary R, take any function and then I will extend it to the whole of X. That is enough, because then given any t, I can choose r to be smaller than that and apply whatever I have done here. Okay. So look at the function restricted to the boundary of BR of X intersection X, that's A. Now this A is a subset of boundary of BR of X, right? And this is taking place inside Rn. So this is subset of Sn minus 1, closed subset. Okay, this gives a map F prime from A to Sn minus 1, and A is a closed subset of this sphere. Therefore, by previous corollary, there is a continuous function G which extends F prime on the whole of Sn minus 1. So this is the theorem that we are using here, 6.3, that it can be extended. The corollary is 6.3. All right. So now take a point P in the complement of BR of X minus X, BR on X. Why I am saying this? Because X is a relative boundary, is what we have assumed. So every open set around X will intersect both X and its complement. So take a point inside here, which is not in X. Okay. Now let eta from X to the boundary of this be the radial projection from the point P. The radial projections are defined on the entire of Rn minus P. What is the meaning of radial projection? Every point of Rn minus P has a unique expression, like a polar coordinates, as if P is the origin, right? So So that eta is the radial projection. After that, all that I do is define hx to be fx on all points not in U. On the x, I am defining this whole map. Not in U, it is fx. If it's in the complete in the U bar, inside U as well as the boundary, U is this set, right? So inside U as well as the boundary, define it as g of eta x. When x belongs to the boundary as well as inside x, then these two will coincide because of what? The eta on the boundary of this point is identity. If x is a point on here itself, then eta of x will be x itself. Okay. And this is just, g is just extension of, what is g? G is just extension of this f prime that we had. So, okay, f prime is nothing but f restricted. So it is fx only. It's just a notation here. F prime is f itself restricted to a. Okay, so on the intersection, they coincide. Therefore, both of them are closed subsets. Therefore, h is a continuous function. Okay, and obviously, it's an extension of f. So what we have done is, every function f defined on the complement of an open bar can be extended to the whole of x. Okay, assuming that x is a relative boundary. Notice that relative boundary has been used, that p is an outside point is there. All right, here is a picture. So p is an outside point, this is the ball br of x. X is a point here. Well, I have drawn it on the boundary. So you may ask, oh, you are already boundary. It's a boundary point in what sense? I am using only point set topology here. This set, open ball, will intersect both x as well as complement of x. Okay, no matter what br of x is, what r is, x is a relative boundary, that's all I'm using. So look at this projection map. Okay. And whenever this ball intersects this part, for example, is both in x as well as in the boundary, where does this point go? It will go to this point only. If a point is here, where will it go? It will come to a point here. That is a radial projection. Every point here will come here. Okay. So I am taking this radial projection, which is defined on the whole of Rn minus p, restricted to x. Okay, so this will map like this into this one. Points here will be mapped here and so on. In any case, the entire thing will be contained inside Sn minus 1, the projection onto this one. Okay, this is the picture of the radial projection. All right, so one way we have proved, we have to prove the other way around now. Suppose this criterion is true, then I want to prove that x is the relative boundary. Instead of that, what I am doing is, if it is not a relative boundary, it's a point of x, not a relative boundary, means it is a relative interior point, then the criterion is false. Namely, I must find a t such that no matter what r I take, smaller than t, okay, there will be some function which cannot be extended. Right? So you have to read the negative of that statement correctly. Okay. So take x to be a relative interior point. Let t be positive, any. Okay. If I show for some t, okay, there is something like that. Okay. If we are for each t with some property, you can choose something smaller than that, and that t has something smaller than that. So if I prove one such thing, then the criterion is gone. That's why I can assume that u, which is this notation bt of x. Okay, this u was different earlier, right? So this is now it is different. So that's why I am putting a definition here each time. It's contained in the boundary. It is contained in the whole of x. This is possible. This is possible because x is a relative integer. For every t, there must be an r. Blah blah blah. Right? To say the negative, I can choose my t, so I have chosen this t. Now, for every r, I have to say something is wrong. So let f from x minus x to xn minus 1. See, I just throw away the center of this ball, which is a point of x after all. Okay? To xn minus 1, b, this map, which is defined on the whole of Rn minus singleton point x. This is again the radial projection. Y minus x divided by norm of y minus x. If x was origin, it would have been y divided by norm y. We have studied that one. Rn minus 0 to Sn minus 1. Okay, so now because x is treated as an origin, so you have to say y minus x was norm of y. This vector is always. This makes sense because y is not equal to x. See, I am defining it on Rn minus 1. Then I am restricting it to x. This is x is a subset of that. Okay, so y minus x by norm y minus x is always a norm 1. So it's a map from x to Sn minus 1. Okay, it is from x minus x to Sn minus 1. Suppose you can extend this to the whole of x. Okay. Which will be an extension of f restrict to x minus u also. Okay. Suppose there is a map G which is an extension of f restrict to x minus u only. U whole u is contained inside x, right? Suppose there is such an extension. Then what I do is I look at this new map phi of v, which is g of t times v plus x. Take any v, okay, in dn, which is norm of v is less than equal to 1. Multiply it by t, it will become a norm equal to, at the most equal to t, right, from dn. You add it, add the point x, it will be inside this ball, the closed ball. You got it? I have just translated, first multiplied by t and translated the vector. So that vector will be inside t, inside here. So it will be inside x. We take g of that, makes sense. Call that as phi. That's a map from dn to Sn minus 1. Right? Dn is boundary of this one. Start with any dn. When it's on the boundary, it will go to the boundary of this one. Okay. So take this map. This is really continuous translation, so scalar multiplication, and then applying G. So composites of various continuous functions. If norm of V is 1, then namely it is on the boundary of this, norm of T V will be equal to T. So Tx minus V will be of norm that. This tx plus x minus v. So that means this plus this is precisely on the boundary of this one, of bt of x. Right? So if norm of t is 1, then this is in the boundary. Therefore, phi of this, which is defined like this one, which is the extension of g is an extension of x, is f of t v plus x. Okay? And that is equal to v. F of t, what is f of anything? F of anything is y minus x divided by norm y, right? So look at that map f. Tv of x plus x minus x is tv divided by its norm, which is t. So that's v. Okay. So phi v is identity, phi identity on the boundary. All right. Now you see, This means that phi is a retraction of dn onto its boundary. It's a contradiction to our theorem 6.5 that we have used to prove what? Brouwer's fixed point theorem. So we are using Sperner lemma also indirectly here. So we couldn't have proved this theorem without that. Okay. So we have proved, we have used that one. So this is a contradiction. Thus we have proved that f restricted to x minus 2 cannot be extended to x. Extension, if there is such an extension, what we have proved is that there is a contradiction that dn retracts to its boundary. Okay. Now you take any r less than t, okay, then take v equal to br of x, then f restricted to v, the same function, cannot be extended because even f restricted to the boundary, even the smaller thing cannot be extended. If v is br of x, then v is a smaller subset than u. X minus u, f restricted to even that cannot be extended. So this cannot be extended, obviously. If there is an extension of this one, then there will be extension of f of x minus u also. But just now we proved that f restricted x minus u cannot be extended. So this completes the proof of the theorem. Let us stop here and we will complete the proof next time.